How do you define success? Not how does a dictionary define it, or how do your parents define it, or how do the advertisers define it, but how do you define success? I've become really fascinated by this question, having changed my definition of success several times during my life. I've also redefined failure in a whole load of ways, but that's too big a topic for an 18-minute talk. I'd like to talk a little bit today about the way that we in the Western world tend to think of success and what I fear the implications of that might be if the rest of the world buys into that same concept. But first of all, I'd like to give you a little bit of background about the different evolutions that I've been through and my own definition of success. I started out, as most people do, as a baby. This is me, aged 2 weeks old, with my beautiful mother in Cheshire in England. And as I grew up, for me, success meant academic success. I was in a poor family. My parents were both Methodist preachers, and we didn't have very much money at all. It's not really the kind of job that you go into for the fast cars and flashy lifestyle. But they were ambitious for me academically, and so they would always help me with homework and make sure that I pushed myself hard. And after many years of hard graft, they were delighted when I won a place at Oxford University. My sister went to Cambridge, which would be a bit like me going to Harvard and her going to Yale. Actually, no, let's switch that around. But we are still speaking to each other. But in the meantime, something had happened. When I was 16, just a couple of years before I went to Oxford, we came to America for the first time. My father did a work exchange in San Diego in Southern California, in a very affluent suburb of San Diego, no less. And for the first time in my life, I was exposed to this amazing Californian lifestyle where people actually had more than one bathroom in their house. And they had swimming pools, and we went to the beach all the time, and we ate ice creams as big as your head. And I just was blown away by this kind of lifestyle. And that was what I really wanted. I just about managed to scrape through my degree because I was so sidetracked actually by rowing. In those days, I said at university, I studied law, beer, and rowing, but not necessarily in that order. When I graduated in 1989, it was Thatcher's Britain and Reagan's America, and I wanted that London yuppie lifestyle. I wanted the big house and all the stuff to put into it. And so over the next 11 years, I pursued that dream. I was working as a management consultant in London, and on the face of it, it looked like I was living a successful life. But inside, something was happening. There was this gradually growing feeling that this wasn't the life that I wanted to be living. There was a disconnect between the person that I felt I was on the inside and the person that I was pretending to be on the outside. And what really brought this home to me was one day when, in an effort to find the answer to this question, what's wrong with me, I sat down and wrote two versions of my own obituary, the one that I wanted and the one that I was heading for. And I found that they were very different. And that made me realize that I needed to make some dramatic changes or end up regretting the life that I could have had. So to cut a very long story short, and via an environmental epiphany, I found myself in my mid-30s signing up to row across oceans. And I'm just going to show you a short video now to give you a little bit of an idea of what that might look like.
How can you see into my eyes like open doors, leading you down into my core, where I become so numb without a soul?
I'm not having a good day. My right shoulder blade is giving me serious jip. Quite a bit of pain with the shoulder and stuff. All kind of crusty. My bum is really sore. Just keep going, just keep rowing. This is the trouble with oceans. It seems to be always not enough of something, or too much of it. Absolute dead calm. And this is choppy compared with what it was like first thing. The wind is pushing me south. It's being pushed north. See now, south of Antigua, more south. Weary, and I've been out here for too long, and I can't get on the phone to have a whinge to anybody else. Very, very hard going. Oh my god, but it's gonna be hard. A strong urge just to curl up in my bunk. Tired, pissed off, sore. Yeah. It's tough. It's tough to take.
So ocean rowing pretty much sucks, and I wouldn't recommend it to anybody unless you have a really burning need to get an environmental message out there. But it has taught me some very important things about success. I've had to learn to redefine my success. After the academic success and then the financial success, what's meant the most to me has been this more spiritual success that has come from my life on the ocean. As the ocean stripped away everything during that Atlantic row, I discovered how little I really need. I came to really cherish simplicity. I found that having a sense of meaning and purpose meant so much more than having the latest kitchen. The sense of community that I felt with the people ashore, the people who'd supported me, who posted comments on my blog, who really believed in what I was doing. And I discovered how important it is that I should define my own success and what really mattered to me by those criteria that I discovered when I wrote those two versions of my own obituary. So I'm not saying that this is the right way to live a life. Obviously, you'd have to be a bit eccentric to want to do this kind of thing specifically. But I just invite you to think about what would make you feel that you've lived a successful life. Does it have to be the materialistic lifestyle? At the moment, we already would need 1.5 Earths to support the human species. If all of the world, I'm sorry if I sound like I'm beating up on Americans, I'm really not, but if all the world lived like Americans, we would actually need 5 Earths to support the 7 billion people that we now have. So there's a real environmental imperative to rethink how we define success. If we can find happiness in non-material things, in our relationships, in our sense of community, in our sense of achievement, rather than in consumerism, then in one fell swoop, we can actually be happier and more fulfilled and massively reduce our environmental impact. When I graduated from university, we were told that the future was ours for the taking. I'd like to suggest today that the future is ours for the making. We can make it a happier, healthier, more sustainable future, depending on how we choose to define success, or else we end up possibly facing the biggest failure of all, the extinction of the human species. On that note, I would like to wish you all great success in your lives. Thank you very much for listening this afternoon. Thank you.